second favorite record of all time, right after The End of the World, and the finest instrumental ever. Love that record. And it was popular in exactly this moment, December 62. So that's 56 years ago. Holy mackerel. Wow. I did not need to say that out loud. I love that record. All right. So today was the Radio Dream Lunch. And Art Vuolo is here to kind of explain how it all started and why he does this, why this guy from the Midwest gathers people on the West Coast together selflessly. What does he get out of it? And we all get together. It used to be at a restaurant, and for a minute it went back to a restaurant. Bad idea, because we're noisy and messy. Same way I like my women.
Yeah.
But we usually hold this gathering at a home, and I can take the rest of the hour to describe this home. It's not really a home. It's a museum with a bedroom in it, and it is the home of a guy that we're all friends with, who has the world's most massive collection of promotional paraphernalia, rare album jackets, magazines, plaques, satin jackets. Every 45 that ever charted in Billboard, and I'm not going to even say his name because I don't want to put him on any radars. He's just very generous to let us go into his house, it's a marvelous place to meet because you feel like you're meeting at the Grammy Museum or something like that. The whole thing is well put together, and it's put together by Art Vuolo, who is here in the studio with us in Los Angeles. So, Art, welcome to the diner.
Thank you.
Get in close.
I'm hugging the microphone.
Explain to people. You call yourself. We all know you as radio's best friend. But what is your?
No, I didn't come up with that.
Who came up with it?
Shannon claims he came up with it in New York. Oh. Although John Leader today said that he came up with it. So now we don't know for sure.
Oh. You know? All right. So you didn't make it up.
I'm not self-proclaimed.
All right. Just tell us just quickly about your love for radio, but also how you sort of made loving radio a profession. You know, how that happened.
Well, basically, I mean, I had a company that put out radio guides that directed people to their favorite radio stations all around the country. Of course, now with satellite radio, you don't need that. You don't run out of satellite.
So, what would I do with your radio guide in 1972?
You would say, "Well, I'm in Philadelphia. I can listen to back in the old days, WIBG."
So, if WFIL. I'm going to be on a road trip, I would take your book and I would say, "Okay, we're approaching Milwaukee. Let's
see." Yeah, it was a pamphlet type thing. Uh-huh. I did it with John's station, WLS in Chicago. Great stations all across America tied into the thing. They promoted it on the air. We put them in fast food restaurants and 7-Eleven stores.
So this was a business, a profit center for you.
I actually put out 100 million of these things, so my house is paid for.
But give or take. Yeah. But who's counting?
But I've loved radio. I've loved it for years, you know. But when satellite radio came out, I fell in love with it because you're playing music that you can't get on regular terrestrial radio anymore. And that was the big appeal for me. Right. You know, plus the fact you have disc jockeys that are personalities.
Yes.
Really? This room right now is filled with personalities.
Real life personalities.
Yeah, we got to talk to some of them.
We are going to talk to them.
Don't waste a lot of time.
No. I'm trying to explain it. Oh, so once a year, Art, who loves radio as much as anyone on the planet, loves radio and also has made a career out of videotaping disc jockeys. So you can see some of your favorite disc jockeys.
Yeah, they're called the Video Air Checks. And I have the biggest collection, I guess, of anybody in the nation. Sadly, these days, I'm using a lot of those videos for memorials because we're losing so many of them. Dan Ingram this past year, and many, many other greats. And I am, in fact, the only person that had any video of Dan Ingram, period.
Disc jockeys over the years have permitted you to come into the control room and videotape them while they're on the air.
Yes.
And then you make this edited videotape of here's what so-and-so looks like when they're working at W-blank.
Everybody wants to know what's going on behind the curtain, and people want to know what's happening in the studio. They get a chance to...
So you've turned your love and your passion into good ideas, and then the Radio Dream Lunch, what was it, 12 years ago? 11 years ago?
No, 10 years ago. This was the 10th and final one. Even though you wanted to keep going...
No, it's not the final one.
It is the final one.
No, it's not the final one. You're doing that thing.
He's
it's
not going to know. He's going to be
like
wandering
a YouTube
the streets
farewell,
next year.
Their third farewell tour and all that. You're not saying
Lou's going to say, what am I going to do? It's the end of the year. And there's no
I'm just going to go stand outside of Steve's house and just look at it.
There you
but
go.
But no. So you got this idea 10 years ago. Why the West Coast?
I don't. We were out here, and I don't even remember. I've been out here a lot of times this time of the year, and we just decided to have lunch. Six people decided to have lunch at Marie Callender's restaurant, and we said let's do it again next year. And each year it got bigger and bigger and bigger, and it was crazy. And we can't get over how popular it got. But you know, it's wearing on me. You know, everything's got a beginning and an end. This is the end. You know, if somebody else wants to do something, that's great, but I'm tired, okay? And I love radio, and I love all these people, and I'm so happy we're in your studio tonight, but I do want you to talk to them.
Well, I am, and okay. So that is what happened today. It was a group of radio guys and gals who get together once a year, because Art is generous and pulls us all together, and we all get to hobnob and eat barbecue and tell stories and tell people that we were at one time more popular and famous than we actually were. That said, three of those legends have followed us into the studio tonight, and I'm thrilled that they're here. They're each great at what they do, and each very different with what they do. And so in no particular, or well, we could do it alphabetically, can't we? Shotgun Tom Kelly is a... he's a San Diego radio legend who then became a Los Angeles radio legend and is now on Sirius XM 60s on 6 weeknights, well, when Brucey's not on, so Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday nights across the country. And is just one of the most recognizable and loved radio DJs, has a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, which, you know, none of us can, you know, he's up there in like Wink Martindaleville.
yeah.
Dick Clark Town, and is also one of the sweetest people on the planet. So Shotgun Tom, welcome.
God, it's great to be here. Great to, what a great show. I love you. You're talking about all these great songs that I love. And by the way, the Tornadoes and Telstar is my favorite.
Isn't that just a great record?
Oh, it's fantastic, man. I got it on my phone, man.
Why don't we not talk to... Why don't we just sit here and just talk about Telstar the rest of the night?
We could do that, but we don't want to do that.
All right, we're not.
There's so much more to talk about.
John Landecker, Chicago is such an important city in the history of rock and roll, in the history of blues and R&B, therefore rock and roll, and such a great radio town. There were a few radio stations that drove the train once the FM era came, with the WLUP, et cetera, but man, in the WLS, WCFL era, you had a classic radio battle, and you had incredible disc jockeys, and what a city. But John worked in many other great towns too, but he's really considered like a real child of Chicago radio. But John Landecker.
That's me. Oh, sorry. Yeah. Hey, Lou. How are you?
Your time at Wibbage in
Philadelphia.
Yeah, precedes your time in Chicago.
Yes, it does.
Now, Wibbage was the... I grew up in the New York market and listened to New York radio, and Wibbage was our WMCA. It had the longer playlist and the weaker signal.
Well, not when I got there, it didn't.
Oh, when you got there, it had what, a shorter?
when I got there, I became Scott Walker. So I think that says it all. Okay?
No.
We didn't have a long anything.
Scott Walker.
Maybe there was a long line to the restroom, but but that was as long as it got.
But eventually Wibbage did, WIBG did have, didn't they? They were yes. Played a lot more records.
Once the station was sold and new people came in, about 1970, somewhere in there, and I became music director.
Ooh.
And that's when all that happened.
That's what you were getting refrigerators and all kinds of stuff.
Jukeboxes, hundreds of dollars.
What?
Cocaine, prostitutes, cars that go in reverse.
Prostitutes.
Trips to Vegas.
Prostitutes with refrigerators.
That's right. Have you seen them?
No.
We had prostitutes coming out of refrigerators.
Out of refrigerators with cocaine.
It was a great time.
I'm sure it was a great time.
I met Joey there.
Well, hang on, Joe. No, listeners don't even know that Joey's here yet.
Yeah,
so they think you mean Joey Heatherton.
I don't know I'm here yet.
I don't know which Joey you met.
Joey Reynolds.
One thing. Is it true that the original call letters stood for I Believe in God?
Yes, it is.
Always wondered about that.
Wow. Well, it's true.
Move it over here and I'll explain it to you.
No,
WIBG was founded in the basement of a Presbyterian church, 1922.
Yeah. Wow. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay. And, you know, Joey Reynolds worked at one of the greatest, coolest radio stations ever. And I say that because we all could listen to it at night.
Yep.
I think that WKBW in Buffalo had more listeners outside of Buffalo than it probably did in Buffalo. Mm-hmm. And I was one of them. I would listen to that thing. He also went on to work at I don't know how many people in the room worked at a three call letter station.
I did.
I did.
Oh. Everyone? I worked at KNX. Wait, I've always wondered. I worked at KNX FM. Does that count as a three call letter?
Sure it does.
Or is it a five?
No,
that's three.
That's three. You could have said WLS AM. You know what I'm saying? The AM doesn't count.
But
it's still the same thing. I mean, you're going to FM and AM. Now
here's
you're
a WLS FM.
And this is the first time I've ever been on a satellite, though.
Oh, how about that? You like
Is Telstar going to go up my ass before we're done?
Telstar? Yes, it is. Telstar's still up there, I guess, isn't it?
Sputnik. I meant Sputnik. The Russians.
Russians. Oh, there you go. See, you had a great opportunity for for topical humor, and you went Telstar.
I know. Thank you.
Joey Reynolds, welcome to the diner. How are you, sir?
I'm good. Thanks for having me here tonight. What time do we go on?
We go on about another hour. This is just practice.
Oh, okay. WIBG is I Believe in God, but I worked at WKBW, which is well-known Bible Witness.
Yes.
And WOOR, which is white-only radio.
Oh. So, you know. It's
free
not.
Religious experience.
That's not what it's good for. you did work at a famous three-call letter.
I've had 40 jobs. You know, I kept getting fired. You know, tonight you'll fire me before the evening's
over. You kept looking for other opportunities.
No, I got fired.
And then right before you found the other opportunity, you got fired.
No. Well, actually, I didn't get into radio to play music. I'm the only guy here that didn't do it for music. I got into radio to be famous and be funny and also to have girls and drugs. But, you know, I didn't do it for the music. I wasn't that much. I was always accused of talking too much and not playing enough records. And so when I came to WIBG in Philadelphia, where John was on right after I was on, you know, he was like a savior because he played music.
A savior?
I think so.
And you were like a epiphany.
Well,
I said, I don't have to play all this music. I'm going to talk about
See,
stuff.
You know, I think what's happened.
And then I got a big job.
Well, we should talk about this a little bit. John and I did something very unusual. There were two things that he brought it up.
Right.
And you know, and you're playing a lot of the hits from Cameo Parkway. There's more to the story than Cameo Parkway. There's a recording studio that they use called Virtue Sound, which is on Broad Street. And where Eddie Holman did
Hey There, Lonely Girl,
you know. And the Virtues with the Guitar Boogie Shuffle. I do know about the music. I'm just saying that I didn't get in it.
Yeah. Gamble Huff.
And you know, that was discovered by John Madeira, who also did Hall & Oates.
That's right.
You know, and wrote at the Hop, and
that's
brother-in-law
right.
to Highlight, one of the disc jockeys, was Len Barry.
And who took the Jim Croce records around?
Oh, Sister Mary.
That's right. An actual nun.
A nun.
No, I'm not kidding.
Well, oh, yeah. She was
No.
She was a principal.
She knew Cashman, Pastilli, whatever it was.
They're really Cashman, Pastilli, and
West. They produced
Jim Croce. Cashman, Pastilli, and West, and Jim Croce.
And one of their sisters was a sister.
And Maury Muehlheiser.
Yes! Muehlheisen.
Well,
he played guitar with them.
Yeah.
So do you know, as a music director, you've got a nun coming into your office to give you a 45. Are you going to say no?
Well, she was over my house cleaning the place. Come
she
on.
Was the sister of Tommy West.
That's right.
Yeah. His real name was Tom Picardo.
No. She's the sister of Terry Minogue, who was Terry Cashman. Terry Cashman.
Who was
And she took me to a Frank Sinatra concert.
What, the nun was
yes.
a Frank
well,
Sinatra
you want me to
concert?
Tell the story? You're going to tell it. Frank Sinatra came to do that return thing that he did at
but he was known as Tex Colorado.
Yeah. Frank Sinatra was over at the Spectrum, which was the stadium or the arena at the time.
Yeah.
And you know, he had a return engagement with Howard Cosell in New York, and then he came on to Philly. But you know, there's when he showed up, Philadelphia is a little bit of an Italian city.
Oh,
and there were a lot of fights. And she was a nun who was at a Catholic school, principal of a Catholic school, when nuns were starting to not to show a little hair. You know, they weren't
wearing...
I beg
your pardon?
They didn't look like penguins. You know, I mean, they were showing a little bit of bangs.
They had a veil.
They had a veil.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And she came over and stayed at my house because I had a guest house. Remember that, John?
Yes, I sure do.
And I had all those dirty pictures in my bedroom, and I had to cover them before they came over to clean the place.
That was a good idea.
But I digress.
But I had a wonderful time with her, and she invited me to see Frank Sinatra, which was... Sid Mark was known for that.
I remember him.
Yeah.
And, you know, he was Sinatra's second best friend because then there was the other guy in New York that always fought with him.
Right.
So we went to the concert, and, you know, there was a big fight all the time about Frank Sinatra. Everybody always fought, the RDA Club and Palumbo's. And I said,
Bobby
Vinton. God, you know, old Black and Blue Eyes is back again. Because they were beating each other up outside of that place to go over to that, they had those Philly steak sandwiches. We had a great time there, didn't we?
Yeah.
And tell them about this concert we had that nobody knew where it was.
Ah.
The Buckley's idea. Listen to this
one. This is right after Bangladesh. Remember the Bangladesh concert?
Wait, I'm going to stop you right there. We take a break. We come back. We talk about the concert right after Bangladesh. I'm going to mark that place.
Okay.
You'll have to remember the story for about 2 minutes.
I'm going to try real hard.
Don't forget, John.
Okay. Bangladesh.
We'll be right back. Stick around, folks.
In the early morning rain,
the bass kicks in on that thing. How long did they rehearse this? 2 seconds. It's that good. All right, welcome to the Diner, Sirius XM Volume 106. I'm Lou Simon. This is what we do on Sunday nights. And tonight, we are guested by some folks who are here in town for an annual get-together of radio war dogs. Joey Reynolds, who is an East Coast legend and a national legend, as well, has been at this game for a number of years in a variety of formats, from top 40 to talk to most everything in between. John Landecker. A legend, makes you think WLS in Chicago, but he also worked in Philadelphia, and we'll ask him where else he set up a shop. And Shotgun Tom Kelly, a West Coast sensation to San Diego and Los Angeles, and now part of Sirius XM 60 on 6.
You better believe it, baby.
Yeah.
There we go.
So you were, John Landecker, you were about to tell us a story.
I was.
You said concert for
We're talking about concert that nobody knows what happened. Okay, so concert at Bangladesh, Madison Square Garden. Joey?
Okay. First of all, let's say this diner here should serve scrapple because of what we're talking about in Philly. And you know what scrapple is, right?
Yes.
It's pig schnauz and everything else you can't
think of.
Delicious. All right, now, Rick Buckley bought WIBG in Philadelphia, and I came from Hartford to Philly as a favor. I wasn't going to stay, and I came into that market, and I didn't want to be there because I didn't think they had a good signal at night, and it was going to be hard to beat WFIL because they were so popular. Yeah. They were giving away cars. We were giving away garages. Remember that? We gave a garage away.
That's right.
Now, you know, Rick Buckley had a very strange sense of humor. He came from L.A., KGIL in Los Angeles. And at the time, he decided that he would have a concert. And we would be the biggest concert in the history of radio anytime, anywhere. But we wouldn't tell the audience where it is.
That's right.
So who was there?
Leon Russell was the concert.
Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young?
No. Leon Russell had played at Bangladesh.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's right.
And the station was at 117 Ridge Pike, Lafayette Hill, Pennsylvania, right near the beautiful area called Conshohocken.
Yeah.
And Conshohocken had like a football field. And that was where the concert was going to be. It was free if you could find it. And the only way you could find it was by listening for clues.
Yeah.
And if you got there, you got there. And if
Sounds
you didn't,
like a
you
brilliant,
didn't.
Brilliant promotion.
And you know what?
Me.
The place was packed.
It was packed.
It was packed. pat. everybody was following the clues. Everybody figured it out. And Leon Russell coming right off the Bangladesh concert was up at an apex at that particular point in his career.
Yes, he was.
You know, he'd just been on stage with George Harrison and Bob Dylan and all this stuff. So it was like it was a really cool thing to do.
And we would go around on dune buggies after school and all the high schools. After school, we each had a dune buggy. And John and I would go out and meet the kids and give them candy. Remember, we were like the early predators.
Early predators?
Yeah, no, my God.
Hey,
we should have been arrested.
There
are prisons filled with people who...
Well, I know. There are prisons filled with people who sold the stuff we were smoking,
There was no predatory thing going on whatsoever.
Only a joke. All right, but John's middle name is Records, and that was a big deal then.
It is still
today. It came from your daddy. Tell him your father.
No, it came from my mom.
Well, your mother?
My mother's maiden name was Marjorie Victoria Records.
And your father was a teacher. He was a
professor. University of Michigan.
Very smart kid. And and John had a beautiful wife and children, and the rest of us were still looking.
So
he had no reason to go out and hunt.
Shotgun Tom, you've got stories from your many, many years in... let's go back to San Diego. You were in San Diego starting in the 70s.
Yes, yeah, at KCBQ.
Huge radio station.
Yeah, very big, very big. We broke records there.
Well, let's explain what that means, because listeners think that means you snapped them in half.
No.
A hit.
No, I remember we had a guy by the name of Buzz Bennett as the program director, and... this record promoter brought in a Rod Stewart song and wanted us to play it.
Mm.
And Buzz said, okay, let's hear it. And it was Reason to Believe, and which is a very pretty song.
Beautiful song.
And so Buzz goes, oh, wow, man. And he talked like this because he was very hip, man. And so he said, well, that's a nice song, man, but I want to hear the B-side. Well, the record promoter said, no, Rod Stewart hates that side. There's a big mistake. No, we just threw it on there for Phil. No, we do not want that side.
Right.
Well, I'm going to listen to it anyway, man. I just want to see what it sounds like. So he turned it over, and he listened to it, and he goes, wow, man, you know, I like that so much, I'm going to create a contest around it. Oh, no, Rod wouldn't like it, and we don't want it. No, I'm going to do it, man. And here's what the contest is going to be called. Count the number of times KCBQ plays Maggie May and win $1,000 in case of a tie, we'll draw. We had a real easy 13 times, and... you could enter as many times as you want, and everybody had the same answer. So we had a big truck out in the parking lot, and we drew the winning name. It was a blind guy by the name of Joe Renzi.
He's a good producer.
He went I think he had 2,000 entries with the right one. But that was it. We broke Maggie May.
Because the program director liked it better than Reason to
Believe. I want to ask you about something. You were talking about instrumentation earlier on in the show in the last hour. Did you know the instrument we used on Sherry? You know, I went to the recording session. That's how I broke the record, breaking a record.
You did.
Played it for 4 hours in
you got
Hartford.
Fired too. Hang on a second. So hold on a second. So we're talking to Joey Reynolds right now.
Yeah.
And the record's Sherry in 1962 by the Four Seasons. Why were you at that recording session?
Because I was friends with Bob Crewe, and I played all his records that didn't make it. And all of a sudden, he had this background group, and we ran out of money. So what instrument did he use? That's what I was getting at. This is a good trivia thing, because
I was
playing that earlier. The instrument he used was English boots. Sherry, baby.
One of their stomping boots.
Yeah, that's right, exactly. And Charlie Colello, you know, the boys played instruments, and Charlie Colello was the arranger at the time, and Bob Crewe was standing on this board, getting a sound out of it to make an instrument out of it. So I played the record for 4 hours. It's in Jersey Boys. I'm the guy that locked myself in the studio.
Out of the movie. Screwed out of the movie.
Well, no.
Frankie Clint Eastwood.
Frankie was not happy with the movie anyway, because he thought that Clint Eastwood made a dark movie instead of a light movie. Now, you know, on Broadway, when you see Jersey Boys or when you see it in theatrical, it's an upbeat, it's about the music. I mean, you know, it's every song's a hit.
Right.
But when you watch the movie, it's about stealing hubcaps. You know, I mean, that's not exactly the image that Frankie has about himself.
So you were at the recording session for Sherry.
Yeah, I was.
And you had that record in what radio station?
I did not have
station?
A record. I had an acetate.
What's radio station were you working at?
WPOP in Hartford. And I played it for 4 hours. You know why I didn't get fired?
No.
Because and the cops came and they stopped me, and because the program director was Morton Downey Jr. He was crazier than me.
who called the police?
The audience, like they would hear on the show.
They thought something was wrong.
Yeah. No, they knew something was wrong. I'm playing the same record two over acetates, and over again. But I'm wearing the mouse so much I was playing the flip side. There was no flip side.
What's the police call for that?
Because they wonder what's happening with the disc jockey.
What I'm saying, how do they even tell the patrolman to go by the radio station?
In those days, now let's put this in frame. In those days, the jock was bigger than the music, and we were very popular. You know, you listen to the disc jockey, you don't listen to the records.
So they
the records
thought it was like a hostage situation.
No. The records can't. Most people who formatted stations couldn't do what we were doing. They didn't have the personality. Paul Dre had the personality of a brick. You know, I mean, this is a guy that programmed a radio station. He had no talent.
Well, maybe they were concerned you had a heart attack or something.
The same with Boss Radio. Who the hell is going to call it Boss Radio?
Let's look at the ire of their estate or their widows.
I don't care about their widows.
Well, I
they're sitting there trying to get
the boss,
money.
They're boss widows.
They're going to take money that they didn't earn. Come on.
John, talk to us. By the way, if you're just tuning in, we're going to take a quick break and come back.
Again?
Yes.
Wow.
John, I thought there were no commercials here.
No.
No? But, you got commercials?
But when we come back, John's going to tell us a little Debbie Boone story.
I am. It's a lovely Debbie Boone story that everybody is going to want to stay tuned for.
And wait, there's a John Lennon story.
Uh-oh, that's mine.
Oh, I know what that story is.
I'm so embarrassed.
I know what that story is.
Who's Debbie Boone's mother-in-law?
Pat Boone's wife.
No.
Rosemary Clooney.
Rosemary Clooney. That's right, exactly.
I don't know. I don't care.
I know you don't.
Two things you should know. I don't know. I don't care. All right, we come right back. We're in the diner on Sirius XM Volume Channel 106.
All it glitters is gold, and she's buying the stairway to heaven.
African Beat, Bert Kempfert. I special ordered this 45. You can hear why. I had to have it. Wait, it's... I know the trombone part is great. When the strings come in, they did a string arrangement. It's coming up somewhere. Right there. Isn't that delicious? The drummers go a little hog wild there in Berlin. They make these records in Berlin. Yeah, I think. Or somewhere. Trombone player's getting a little worn out now. He's saying, you know, you have me doing the same thing over and over for 2.5 minutes here, Bert. Bert's out back having a smoke. He's no way he's paying attention to what's going on. Now that I listen back to it, this is awful. All right, I'm kidding. Hey, welcome to the diner on Sirius XM Volume. It actually is rather repetitious, isn't it? Yeah. Anyway, so listen, I got a room full of radio legends here that Art Vuolo brought together for Shotgun Tom Kelly, Joey Reynolds, and John Landecker, who could entertain you for hours regaling you with stories of on-air mishaps and crazy promotions, and forget the people they worked alongside.
Lou, I'm sorry. Forgive me.
No. I'm thrilled you did.
So you want this Debbie Boone thing?
I want a Debbie Boone story from John Landecker, yeah.
All right, so I'm at WLS. Yeah. I'm at night, which meant at that particular point I was the teen jock, and I played rock and roll, and Debbie Boone was not. And You Light Up My Life was a huge record.
Huge record.
And I'm sure people realize that radio stations repeat songs over and over and over again. And Debbie Boone made it into the top 4 or 5, and we had corresponding 90-minute countdown stopwatches, that whenever that 90-minute stopwatch came to its end, you had to play next the corresponding song, which meant that You Light Up My Life was on the air all the time, which did not serve my purpose as being a nighttime disc jockey. So, I went on the air and said, You know, I don't like this record. But I know that many of you do because it's so popular. So I've come up with a way to get around all this. I'm going to play Debbie Boone's You Light Up My Life in installments. What we're going to do, and about this time the door opens to the studio and the program director, John Guerin, comes in, and I turn his microphone on. What I'm going to do is play like 15 seconds of You Light Up My Life right now, and then in 30 minutes I'll pick up the following 15 seconds, and so on and so on, until we get to the end of the show where you'll hear the last 15 seconds of You Light Up My Life. And after a very brief conversation on the air, I got John to admit that the possibility existed that someone would stick around the entire evening to see if I actually did that. And I did do that. And then, what I don't know what it was, in the 90s, what year would have, what anniversary of You Light Up My Life would have been there?
97, whatever, 20 years.
Whatever. So I was on an oldie station in Chicago, and we took an entire year to play You Light Up My Life. And at the end of it, we had Debbie Boone on.
Oh, now, how did she react?
She was fantastic. She had a sense of humor. I mean, it wasn't malicious. It was, it was fun.
That's great.
You know what I'm saying?
You promoted her record.
Well, yeah.
Yeah. Sure, it got more attention than if he played it.
Right.
Yeah,
people would understand what I was talking about.
Yes.
Right.
Well,
and that was the only time John Guerin goes, all right, John. Just this one time.
Don't make a habit of this.
Just this one year.
By the way, we get an email here from Joanne in San Jose. She says, I'm sorry to hear this will be the last Radio Dream Lunch. I recall, you talking about it previously on the air. I loved watching the videos done by Art of the previous Dream Lunches.
Oh,
I got to see many of the disc jockeys that I had read about in numerous biographies and radio books over the years. And I'm loving hearing Shotgun Tom during my evening commute.
Oh, I love that.
I had previously only known him from Art's Radio Lunch video.
Oh, thank you, Joanne.
You've come alive for her now.
Oh, I love that.
Happy New Year to the whole Diner family, especially you, Lou's love. Joanne. Thank you, Joanne. Yes. She's wonderful up in Northern California.
Great song by, who did the Joanne?
It was Mike Nesmith and the First National Band.
Lady Gaga.
Yeah. And Lady Gaga is Joanne. Yeah, she did an album called Joanne.
Good song.
So more we don't even have time to get into any of my stories, but mine aren't nearly as legendary as yours.
What did you want to do, Joey? You said you wanted to...
No, I was going
to
say that there was a time in your life when you went to work in Toronto.
Yes.
And you had to have Canadian content.
That's right.
Which is, you had to play a certain amount of Canadian music
if
you were going to be on a Canadian radio station in Canada.
Right. That's right.
And you were forced to play Bobby Curtola and... a lot of people that you, the Snowbird, what was her name?
Ann Murray.
You had to play that four times an hour.
Martha and the Muffins.
Martha and the Muffins.
And, everybody else is playing Motown, and you're sitting there playing these Eskimos.
Con-can or whatever. Yeah.
Does this satellite get into Canada? Yeah. Huh? Does this get into Canada?
All over the world,
No, not all over the world. You have to have
Canada. If you have an app and you're overseas,
do you realize I was the first satellite jock? Did you know that?
Yeah, no.
You didn't know that?
No.
Tell him,
Art.
Tell him he was. From the Dick and Bird Studios right here in L.A. Right.
I did the first satellite broadcast, so I'm the father of satellite.
What does that mean? How are people able to hear it?
By having a dish.
Oh.
Or a radio station.
Or a fork and a spoon.
The guy who started this thing, well, mostly a spoon, because we were doing a lot of drugs.
Okay.
John didn't do that. John's not a predator, and he used a Coke fork. But, we had these satellite broadcasts from Hollywood every Sunday night, and I was the host. It was called Satellite Live, and what we did was, the guys who put it together was Jim Rush, whose father was the president of Columbia, and Pictures, and also they figured out how to use a transponder, and it was, satellites used to be government, and then they became commercial.
Right.
So that's how we got on, and I was on every Sunday, and radio stations carry this. I had all, it was a talk thing. I play some music, but not too much, like you.
Like to say hello to Vladimir Putin.
Well, you know, that's... oh, boy, don't start with that. Come on, we'll be on two other channels that we don't want to know about.
So, wait, I want to hear this incredible story about John Lennon. And who better to tell it than Shotgun Tom Kelly himself?
There we go.
So embarrassed.
I love this story.
I know. Well, you know, I've been known to make...
It never gets old.
Yeah, I know.
It never gets old. That's
I know. My program director...
We get old, it doesn't.
I know. Everybody knows... my program director, Johnny K., embarrassed me by telling this story when I got my star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, right in front of Stevie Wonder. He was there, and he was laughing. Everybody laughed. So, hey, feel free. You're good. I'm going to tell you this story, and when you hit to the punchline, you're going to pause for about a second, or no, a half a second, and then you're going to figure out how Shotgun Tom made a big blunder. Anyway, I was at KCBQ. And Buzz Bennett, oh, wow, man, the guy that talks like that.
The Maggie May guy.
That's right, the Maggie May guy, you know. He was a little upset because KHJ here in Los Angeles would always get the world exclusives. And they were set to get the world exclusive of the brand new John Lennon song. And John was on his own schedule. We never knew when it was going to come out. So Buzz made a deal. Said, listen, why don't you let KCBQ play the new John Lennon song, and KHJ can play it the next day. And here's what we'll do for you. We will have PSA Airlines fly down with the acetate. We'll have an armored truck at the airport with a motorcycle escort, and we will escort the armored truck out to the radio station in Santee, which is out east of San Diego, and we'll roll it in and make a big spectacle on TV. Now, this is when they didn't have video. They were shooting film at the time. So it was a big deal on Channel 8, KFMB down there in San Diego, and we made a big deal about it. And so it all happened. We all month long, KCBQ had promos. KCBQ will have the world exclusive of the new John Lennon song. Keep listening. So anyway, we never knew when it was going to come on, but it came on my show. So the armored truck came in. The TV cameras were rolling behind the glass. I was a little nervous. Anyway, remember an acetate, Lou, about, what, 25 times? I mean, it's...
You can play it about 20 to 25 times, and then the sound actually wears down.
You can play it for 4 hours if you're...
No. Or four hours if you're... If
so anyway, we wanted to get it off this acetate and put it on tape. So we did, and it's a tape cartridge, and... They just hand wrote it with a pen. They didn't type it out. They wanted to get it on the air fast, so they hand wrote the title of the song, and they gave it to my intern, and he rushed it into me. Now I'm a little, my heart's going blah, 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 and I'm seeing the cameras from TV, and now it's my responsibility.
How old are you at this point? 1971.
I was in my 20s, something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, late 20s. The intern gives me the cart, and I put it in the cart machine.
It's a tape cartridge.
Yeah. It's my responsibility with the cameras rolling. Say, all right, ladies and gentlemen, we've been talking to you all month long about KCBQ being the station that's going to play the world exclusive of the brand new John Lennon song. Well, right here on the Shotgun Tom Kelly Show, I have that song, and we are so excited to play the world exclusive John Lennon song. And I look down at the cart and I go, that brand new John Lennon song right here on KCBQ and the Shotgun Tom Kelly Show, Imogene. See, I told you for half a second. Imagine. Well, you know, I went to Catholic school, and the nuns always said, now, Thomas, sound out the word. Imogene. So, you know. Anyway, I was always embarrassed. By the way, there's radio guys down in San Diego, Jeff and Jer. They told it. They loved it. There was a sportscaster, Ted Leitner, who calls the Padre games. There was a rainout in St. Louis.
He told the story to fill time?
Yes, he did. Because he did all the score. So let me tell you about my friend Shotgun Tom Kelly.
He played Imagine, the big buildup. I mean, it's like it's the most important record in the world,
yeah.
And he gets the title.
Well,
wrong.
Nobody told them what the song was beforehand.
No, I didn't know
what the title was going to be.
And they didn't type it on there. They
hand-wrote it. Imaging.
Yeah, Imaging. Now, listen, had I done that correctly, we wouldn't be talking
about
it.
There's no story. You wouldn't even be here.
And there's no story.
You wouldn't even be
here. So, actually, on my blunder, if you want to laugh... with me on that.
No, I'm laughing at you.
Oh, well, that's fine. You can do that.
Here's a note from Pam, a listener in Newington, Connecticut, who says, I remember when Joey Reynolds was on WDRC. Is that true, Joey?
Yeah, that was another one of my 40 stations.
And you, and pretty much, Pam, you can throw a dart if there's a tower, a radio station. He worked there, but in this case, WDRC. And he said, you stayed on the air playing In the Midnight Hour for quite a while. I don't know how long, but I remember that. She said, I was a little kid when
it
happened.
Well, the record got stuck. It was in the midnight.
So what's the big thing with you going on and playing one record for hours?
No, that wasn't staged. I got stuck in an elevator, too, another time. I had to go to the bathroom, and it was on another floor. How about that for a radio station story?
Joey worked at so many stations that when Art published his radio guide, Joey had been on every single one.
There was a little picture of Joey next to every listing.
Well, see, I should have just come here. Then I'd be on all the stations, and there's no problem.
That's right. You come here.
Yeah. You'll want to believe it, baby.
We come right back. Stick around. We're in the diner in L.A.
Oh, there it is. Oh, my God. It's Imogene.
Imogene there.
Listen to this. Listen to the way they mic the drums. Check this out. Listen.
So let it rock. Let it roll. Let the Bible belt come and save my soul.
I mean, that's a cappella, folks.
Hold on to 16 as long as you can. Changes come around real soon. Make us women and men.
Listen. Just great, you know? I mean, he's carrying the whole thing. There's really no drums in this record. It's hand claps throughout until you get to this drum solo in the middle. Very, very unique.
Oh, yeah!
Aside from being catchy as all heck.
Just
great stuff. John Mellencamp. All right, we're in the diner, and we're sitting doing what we love to do. Let's talk about music, in this case, talking about radio. And we're here with John Landecker, Joey Reynolds, and Shotgun Tom Kelly, and also Art Vuolo, who is radio's best friend and brought all these wonderful
people. There was a reference to me working in Canada.
Yeah.
And when that song came out, Jack and Diane, Prince Andrew was dating Koo Stark, who was an alleged actress, and I did a parody song of Jack and Diane called Andrew and Stark. Here's a story about a prince and his lady. Some say she's royal, some say she's shady.
parody records. The power of the disc jockey. Were you in Chicago when Steve Dahl did his?
Oh yeah.
Whole
disco?
Oh
man, let me tell you what happened about that.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm doing assembly programs at high schools.
Yes, you are.
For WLS, and I'm running around, and I go back on the
air. In a dune buggy with candy bars?
No. This is that.
Right.
This is Chicago, so I go to these places, and and we're playing disco music, and the kids are going, you know, John, disco sucks. So I record a chorus of kids going, disco sucks! And I come back to the station and I play it over the intro of every disco song. So then I get called into the general manager's office and he says, listen, you can't say disco sucks on the air anymore. I go, why not? He says, parents are calling and they say it's an obscenity. I say, you don't understand what's going on here. It's not like anybody is actually sucking on anything. It describes something. That chair sucks. Right. This sucks. That sucks. Can't do it. Like about 6 weeks later, Dahl does Disco Demolition at Comiskey Park.
WLUP, a computing station.
Front page of the friggin' newspaper.
Right.
All right. Sucks. Oh, and the general manager at the time said, you mean to tell me if we don't say disco sucks, the ratings are going to suffer? I said, absolutely.
Absolutely.
And they did.
And they did.
Thank you.
End of story.
And that's a national, that was national news.
Oh,
it was.
That's still, yes.
I mean, I remembered it, and I'm not from...
That's a big baseball story, too, because I think they canceled the Tiger doubleheader, I believe, with the White Sox. It was huge.
Everybody's opinion, pretty much, the most remembered promotion in the history of radio.
Oh, I would say so.
Because it went bad, and the man that actually concocted it was Dave Logan, the very same person that hired Flash Phelps, the same person who put together all the channels for XM before the merger with Sirius.
Before the merger, that's right.
And he never gets credit for it, and damn it, I wanted to say it here.
Well, all right, you know, Art. You are Dave Logan's best friend.
I want to tell my story.
I got one thing.
I'm going to take the entire next hour.
You each had a story. NBC in New York.
Oh, yeah.
Rockefeller Center, the lighting of the tree.
Yeah.
I replaced Howard Stern in 1986, and we decided to go outside and do the show from outside every day with the Mighty Unit, which is a portable thing. And I brought my entire cast of...
I worked with Marty Unit. He did middays.
No, that's another guy. He's Jewish.
No, sorry.
So this is a bunch of people who were on my staff, and one of them was became David Letterman's writer, his chief writer, and also Grace Under Fire. She was one of my people. I had a staff of people who were all very, very talented and went on to bigger and better things while I was out of work. So anyway, we were at Lighting of the Tree was something that was going on with the network. And there was Liberace and Helen Hayes at the time and Penn and Teller. And the whole bunch was gathered around for the tree. And we were singing fresh Christmas carols outside. Mm. And I had the NBC crew from radio. And the television people thought that we were the people who were going to do the tree ceremony. So they had a full rehearsal. And I almost got fired because I got everybody to assemble at the wrong time for the wrong reasons. And Liberace came over.
Oh, my God.
And he wore this outrageous fur coat. And I said, where'd you get this thing? He said, that's something I had hanging in the closet. I said, don't be silly. I've been in the closet in years.
You know? No.
So that brought
Where's the drummer?
I'm watching the clock. Because, you know what? I didn't have a chance at all to even do diner stuff. Like, go, we call it going around the booth. Like, everybody has to name a song that starts with
Can I just bring up one little song?
Yes. You did a spoken word.
Hold on a second. Larry from Long Beach, Jordan, wanted to know if Joy Reynolds worked at CBS FM in New York. Yes, no.
No.
Okay. That's a no, Larry. But, we found the one station he didn't work at. Thanks for the email.
But Jay Sorensen did.
But yeah, Jay Sorensen definitely did.
Okay. You did a spoken word 60s on 6 on, you know.
I did a countdown. That idea came from the radio lunch when Wink Martindale came up to me and said, you should really do a countdown of spoken word records.
You were so good at doing those. Huh. And one of my favorite, you picked one of my favorite spoken word songs, Jack Ross from 1962 and Cinderella. And everything was backwards. They lived in a big hark douse with two sissy ugglers who sat around cheating knocklets and Megan Redazines. Yeah. And then they were looking for the slipper slip, and they went from house to house, and you can't turn that around. And at the end, he zips it up, Jack Ross, he's playing the piano. Jack Ross, at the end, he goes, you know, you don't ever want to give up. Abraham Lincoln never gave up.
Mm.
George Washington never gave up. Oliver Twiddledee, who's he? See, you don't know, because he gave up.
Folks, we have to wrap. I have to thank Art Vuolo for bringing in Shotgun
Tom,
Joey Reynolds, John Landecker, radio legends. Thank you, guys.
What fun, man.
Fun. Great sitting here with you. And, folks,
and I have a couple of tickets for you.
Let's
for the
hear
Beatles.
It for Skeeter Davis.
Here's a couple
thank
tickets
you folks
for the Beatles concert.
Thank you. That's great. Thank you, folks, for a great year here in the diner. Let's do it again in 2019. And you know what I always say.
What's that?
The next best thing to listening to music is talking about it. We will do that next week here in the diner. I'm Lou Simon. Thanks for listening. Thanks for calling. Thanks for writing in. Thank you for caring about the music and caring about each other. Happy New Year, be safe, and good night from LA.